Hi guys, welcome to Video Ventures YouTube channel. So if you are checking for DP200 certification, or if you are planning to do, or if you want to learn more thing about the Azure cloud, then you are in the right page. So here I'm going to give the examination pattern overview as well as the real-time questions whatever you will be getting in the Microsoft examination. Then what are the patterns or which area you need to focus more. So all these things I will be including, and I have prepared total 150 questions, and in each set I have added 50 questions. So as part of this video we have 50 questions, and I will be releasing two more YouTube videos regarding this DP200 very soon. So it's in progress, it's almost completed. So yes, so if you are not aware or if you are new to Azure, then guys, I have created one more video that is regarding the Azure fundamental. Please go and look into it. Once you are comfortable in fundamentals, then please come back to this 200 and you can start your journey with the Azure cloud. So Azure and these questions, whatever we prepared, it's those questions are reviewed by the SME, and I have implemented my knowledge, whatever I gained by getting this certification of Azure Data Engineer Associate. So these questions are valid, and you can expect the same questions in the examination, but maybe in random order. But these are the questions very useful. You can check it out, and in the later stage I will be showing along with the answers I will be showing the descriptions as well. So I hope this video will help you guys who are preparing for the examination. So let's start our questions. Then before that I will be giving my introduction in the coming videos. Let's start guys. This is how the exam pattern, since I have completed a Microsoft Azure Data Engineer Associate. So I completed DP200 as well as a 201. So this is the scorecard of my examination. So there will be 1000 marks. Out of that, minimum criteria is 700 marks you need to score. And since because of COVID situation, I was not able to take examination outside, vendor. Instead of that, I took the online session, that is from home itself. So that is also a good option, you guys can go for it. So for these skills measured are implementing data storage solution, then manage and develop data processing 25 to 30%, then monitor and optimize the data solution, that is 30 to 35% you will be getting these questions. So yeah, so once you done, so you'll be, once you complete 200 and 201, you'll be getting a certification. And one thing, you won't get any particular certification only for 200 or 201. If you complete both, then only you will get the Microsoft certified certification. Yeah, or else for 200 and 201 you can have a transcript, or you can have a score report. Those will be the valid. Yeah, let's go to one by one questions. So as I mentioned, these are the questions prepared by adding whatever the questions I got in my examination. So new question, those are not available in other online portals. And also one more thing is, in other online portals, where the, if you check, there are multiple dumps. I don't say that it is not available, but the questions, whatever you are seeing, you can say, if in each website to other website the answers are very different, but here I have prepared the answers by working with the SME as well as by implementing my knowledge. Yeah, so and I don't want to go with the traditional approach, like I will be reading the questions and you will be listening. So instead of that, what I will do, I will pass my voice for 5 seconds. So once that is done, we can go for the answers. Yeah, so the answer for this question is Apache Spark. So since the question is related to Lambda architecture, so Lambda architecture is basically used for the data processing architecture. It's designed to handle massive quantity of data by taking advantage of both batch processing and stream processing methods. And this Lambda architecture, it minimizes the latency involved in querying the big data. So basically Lambda architecture is used for the huge data processing. So that's why here we can go for the Apache Spark, since Apache Spark for the Azure HD instance, it's processing framework that runs large scale data analytics applications. Yeah, let's go to next question.
Yeah, I will wait for 5 seconds. Yeah. So answers are like this: provision an Azure SQL data warehouse instance. It means you need to create a data warehouse in the Azure portal. Next one is connect to the Azure SQL blob storage container by using the SQL Server Management Studio, and connect to the data warehouse with the SSMS. Then third one is build external tables by using the SQL Server Management Studio. That is create external table for data in Azure Blob Storage. So now you are ready to begin the process of loading the data into your new data warehouse. You use external tables to load data from the Azure Blob Storage. So next is you can run T-SQL statement to load the data. That is, you can use like create table as select. This T-SQL statement you can use to load the data from Azure Storage Blob into the new tables in your data warehouse. So one correction here, guys, for the second option, whatever you are seeing, connect to the blob storage container by using SQL Server Management, this is not the answer. Only for the second, why I have not highlighted this earlier, because if you go to the other website or anything, you will be getting this answer, but that second option is not valid. The correct valid option for the second step is connect to the Azure SQL data warehouse by using SQL Server Management Studio. So this is the answer. So rest of them, everything is correct. Yeah, let's go to next question. Yes, let's go to answer. So for this answer is an install on Azure on-premise data gateway as a cluster at each location. It means you can create high availability clusters of on-premise data gateway installations to ensure your organization can access on-premise data resource used in your Power BI reports or dashboards. So such clusters, what it will do, it allow gateway administrator to group gateways to avoid single points of failures in accessing on-premise data resources. So the Power BI services, so whatever other services are there, so those services, it always use the primary gateway in the cluster unless it is not available. So if it is not available, then it will switch the next cluster. So what we need to do, so we need to install an Azure on-premise data gateway as a cluster at each location for this question. Yeah, let's go to next question. Answer for this, it's Azure SQL Data Sync. So it means SQL Data Sync is a service that is built in Azure SQL database that lets you to synchronize the data you select bi-directionally across multiple SQL databases and SQL Server instances. With the Data Sync, what you can do is you can keep your data synchronized between your on-premise database as well as Azure SQL database to enable the hybrid implication. So there, if you compare the data sync along with the transactional replication, there are some advantages are there, like active to active supports, bidirection between on-premise and Azure SQL database. These are supported in the SQL data sync. So some of the disadvantages are also there in the Azure SQL data sync. That is, those are like 5 minute or more latency and no transactional consistency will be there. Higher performance impact will be there. But for this question, Azure SQL data sync is a valid answer. Well, let's go to next question. Yeah, let's go to answer. So it, for this answer, it's B and E, it's rows and tables. For this, it means depending on the choice of the API, I mean for the rows, I'm giving explanation why it is rows, B option, because depending on the choice of the API, Azure Cosmos item can represent either a document in a collection or a row in a table or node or edge in a graph. That is, if you want to know, like, so Cosmos entity, there are multiple APIs like SQL API, Cassandra API, Azure Cosmos DB API, Gremlin API, Table API. So for this, what you can do is for SQL API, the Cosmos item should be document, and Cassandra API, it should be row, and Azure Cosmos DB API, MongoDB is document, then Gremlin API, it uses nodes or edges, then Table API, it uses the item. So that's why for this option, we are going for the B and E, since E, because it's an Azure Cosmos container, is specialized into API specific entities as follows. I mean, as I earlier mentioned, So because of these APIs, where we can go for the rows and tables, that is B and E. Yeah, this is the next question. Yeah, so answer for this question is, elastic pools enable the developer to purchase resources for a pool shared by multiple databases to accommodate unpredictable period of usage by individual databases. It's like sometimes you are not aware, like some particular database, how much resource it takes or how much utilization it will take. So Azure implemented a concept called Azure SQL Database Elastic Pool. What it will do, you can configure the resource for the pool based on either by purchasing the database transactional units or the core based purchasing models. It's like these are the options you will be available for creating these elastic pools. In the later section, I have one more question, that is a practical question. There I will show you how to create the elastic pool and all. So for this answer, it's an EDTU, that is a database transaction units, and the maximum data size. Yeah, let's go to next question. Yeah, so for this, the answer are like this, that is name node, data node, and data node. So I think what you can do is, for the name node, it's like for the first one, it's like HDFC cluster consists of a single name node and a master server that manages the file system namespace and regulate the access to files by the client. And this is for the name node. And what is data node? Data nodes are responsible for serving read and write requests from the file system to the clients. So these things you can select for these options. Let's go to next question. Yeah. So answers are, for the daily sales, you can use Azure SQL Database Elastic Pools, because SQL, as I mentioned earlier, SQL Database Elastic Pools are simple, cost-effective solution for managing and scaling multiple databases that have varying and unpredictable usage demands. If you go for Amazon example, like while they are giving the Amazon festivals, right? So they are not sure like what is the hits for their pages. So in these cases, we can go for the elastic pools. I mean, the database in an elastic pool or on a single Azure SQL database server, and it shares a set number of resources at set price. Elastic pools in Azure SQL database enables software as a service developers to optimize the price performance for the group of database within the prescribed budget. Okay, then why a database hyperscale for the second option, that is weekly analysis? That is because a hyperscale database is an Azure SQL database only, it is not a different one. Then in the hyperscale service tier, that is backed by the hyperscale scale out store technology. In hyperscale database, it supports up to 100 TB of data, and it provides high throughput and performance, as well as it provides the rapid scaling to adopt the workload. I mean, scale in concept and scale out concept, you will come to know. If you want to more details, I have created one more video, that is AZ900, that is the fundamentals of the Azure. I will be providing those links in description. I have already provided them in description, you can go through that. So that is, if whoever is new to Azure, they can go to that and they can watch that video and come back to this. Yeah, so these are the answers. Let's go to next question. Yeah, so answer for this is an Azure SQL Database Managed Instances. It's a managed instance in Azure. It's like a new deployment option available for the SQL database, where it provides near 100% compatibility within the SQL Server on-premise database engine. It provides a native virtual network implementation that address all the security issues or whatever the concerns were there. Everything can be handled by using the database management instances. Yeah, so we are going for these options. Yeah, next one is, yeah. So yeah, maybe I will give 2 seconds for this. answer for this is Azure Resource Management Template. Suppose if you are to create the same template or if you want to deploy the same thing every time, then you can go for the Resource Management Template, where it is easy to create for your application if it is in a single or coordinated option. So such as like extrinsic cluster and their dependent sources, or other sources like Azure SQL databases to Azure Scoop, for the Apache Scoop. So all these things you can do through Azure Resource Management Template. So in this template, you define the resources that are needed for the application, whatever the resource needed for your application. Then you can also specify deployment parameters to input value for different environments. Like you will be having multiple environments in your project, right? So those parameters also you can pass to this resource management template. And this template, it consists of JSON and expressions that you use to construct values for your deployment, as I mentioned, where it uses the input parameters. Let's go to next question. Yeah, answer for this is Table API and Cassandra API. So here, as I mentioned, for the key value you can use the Table API, and for the graphs and all you can use the Gremlin API, and for the document you can use SQL API and MongoDB API, and for the columnar you can use Cassandra API. So it's self-explanatory in this page itself, so I'm not going to expand much on this. Let's move to next question. Yeah. Answer is Data Migration Assistant. With Database Migration Assistant, what it will do, it helps you to upgrade your modern data platform by detecting if there is any compatibility issues that can impact your database functionality in your new version of the Azure. So all these things we can validate. This Data Migration Assistant, it helps you to upgrade or validate all these issues. So this recommends performance or any reliability improvements for your target environments, and it allows you to move your schema, data and uncontained object from your source server to Azure server. So for this option, we are going with the Database Migration Assistant. Yeah, so this is a big question. I can't give much time for this. So what you can do, you guys can pass your videos if you want to see this question. So I'm moving to the answer part. So here, tier 2 archive. As you guys know, we have multiple options for the storage. That is the hot, then cool, so and cold storage. These are the options. If it is if you read complete questions, you will come to know. So here, days after modification in greater than 365, then you need to go for the archive option. If it is more than 10 years, then you need to go for the delete option. Then if you are going for greater than 90, then it's good to go for the tier 2 cool options. So these are the options available. You can go. Let's move to next question. So for these answers are premium service tier, always on availability group, and zone redundant configuration. Where premium or business critical service tier model, what it will do is, it is based on cluster of database engine processes. The architectural models, it completely depend on the fact that there is always quorum of available databases, engine nodes and all. And in the premium model, the Azure SQL database, it will integrate compute and storage on the single node. That is the high availability in this architecture model that is achieved by replication of the computation. So that's why we are going for the premium service tier, because if you consider most of the companies, there should be an availability group, because if your server goes down, then there should be some other server that should be up and that should act as a primary server. Then another one is a zone redundant configuration. For this, what is zone redundant configuration is, by default the quorum set replicas for the local storage configuration are created in the same data centers within the introduction of the availability zone, and you have the ability to place the different replicas in the quorum sets to different availability zones in the same region. So that's why we are going for the zone redundant configuration. Let's move to next question. Yeah, for this the answers are configure the storage account to log read write and delete operation for service type block. Then next one is the use the Azure copy tool to download the log from the dollar logs or blob. Why we are going for the storage log? Explanation is storage logging logs. What it will do? It requests data in a set of blobs in blob container named dollar logs in your storage account. The containers, these containers don't show up if you list all the blob containers in your account, but you can see its content if you access it directly. I mean, suppose if you want to view or analyze your log data, what you should download the blobs that contains the log data if you are interested into the local machine. Many storage browsing tools enables you to download blobs from your storage account. So this storage account, what you can do, you can get it from logs and all whatever are there in a storage account. You can get them from by using the command line Azure copy tool, that is AZ copy, to download your log. So this, so A and B are the valid. So we go to next question. So this is a self-explanatory, no need to tell much on this, where it's like create a new Azure Data Lake storage account with the Azure Key Vault managed encryption keys, then select and configure an encryption key storage container, then add an access policy for the new Azure Data Lake account to the key storage container, then enable encryption on the Azure Data Lake using the Azure portal. Let's move to next question. For this, the answer are the provision an Azure Cosmos DB account with the Azure Table API and enable multi-region rights. And I have this question in the exam, but there it was asking for the three options. So I think these are the options we need to go. That is geo redundancy, multi-region rights, and replicated the data. So these are the options. And it's like I have not got this question. I got the first question whatever I highlighted, but it is good to include first question as well. If I want to give the explanation for the first one, is like a scale read and write throughput globally, you can enable every region to be writable. If you enable multi-region writes, your Cosmos DB account with the table API, I mean, access is very much, as you can see in the question, data must be accessible from application hosted around the world. So that's why the option is enable multi-region writes instead of single writes. Yeah, let's move to next question. Yeah, answer for this is maximum data size and EDTO consumption. So because why it is, because core as part of core purchase model in the general purpose tier, if we are charged for premium blob storage that you provision for your database or Elastic pools. Storage can be configured between 5GB to 4TB with 1GB increments as well. So it depends on the maximum data size as well as the DTU purchase model. I mean, how much your DTU consumes. So total for the Elastic pools, it depends on maximum data size, how much memory you want, then EDTU consumption, that is what is the transaction units of your application. Let's move to next question. Yeah, so these are the questions here, guys. Don't consider whatever highlighted in green, just consider whatever highlighted in yellow, because in I want to show the difference in most of the website or in all the website where it mentioned for the batch processing, it's an HD Insights Spark that we can't do. So the correct answer should be Azure Databricks. So that is data storage should be a Azure Data Lake storage, batch processing should be Azure Databricks, then analytical data store should be Azure Synapse Analytics. It's nothing but a traditional Azure data warehouse. So now Azure Synapse Analytics, that is a Microsoft bought that company, so they kept the same name. I'm not sure why they changed the name from data warehouse to Synapse Analytics. Yeah, let's move to next question. So here also answers are self-explanatory. You need to deploy an Azure Data Factory from the on-premise network. You need to install and configure the self-hosted runtime. I will tell you like self-hosted runtime, integration runtime. So all these different terms in the next video, upcoming set 2 and set 3 questions, those are already included. So I will be sharing soon. Then configure a linked services to connect to the SQL Server instance. Okay. Go to next question. So answer is for each SQL database server, set the Active Directory to the database administrator. So this is the answer for this. We move to next question. I don't give description for all the questions because these are self-explanatory. If it is very complex or something like that, I'm going to give the descriptions. If you have any doubts on any particular question, please feel to comment your questions in the YouTube channel. Yeah, this is the next question. The answer is no, because you can't implement data mask by using the credit card function mask, because guys, you need to consider the questions, you need to read the case study very carefully, because for the data mask, what you need to do is you must use the custom text data masking we need to use, which exposes the first and last characters and adds a custom padding string in the middle. So we need to use custom text data masking, not the credit card function masking. So next question is email functioning mask. So for this also it's no, we can't use email function mask for this question. Then you implement data mask and use the random number function mask. No, we can't use. Yeah, so as I mentioned, for this the answer should be, for this series of question, the answer should be you must use custom text data masking, which exposes the first and last characters and add a custom padding string in the middle. So and guys, one more thing is like for this DP200 question, where there will be like 8 to 9 question, once you give the answer and move to next question, you are not able to return back. So those are the eight to nine questions. Once you click, you can't review them. For other questions, you can review them. So this is a part of that question. So here you can see you will not be able to return to it. As a result, these questions will not appear in the review screen. So guys, you need to take care of that. So this is the next question. Yeah, for the next question, the answers are a data scoped credential. This one is because in order to access your data lake storage account, you need to create a database master key, because what it will do, the master key will encrypt your credential secret used in the next step. I mean, you are going to tell, then you create a, because of that, you need to create a database scoped credential. So next one is external data source. Create an external data source. Use the create external data source, that command you need to use. So a source command to store the location of the data provided the credential created in the previous steps. Next one is the external file format. You need to configure the data format to import the data from the data lake storage, and you need to specify the external file format. Because of this only, this object defines how the files are written to the data lake storage. So this is the answer. We'll move to next question. The answer is replicated. So for this, replicated is the answer, where if you are using any staging tables like that, or if you want more faster query time, or the minimize the data movement and your data is less, then you can go for the replicated table. So there are multiple things like hash distributed, replicated, round robin. So those things will be covered in the next video. Yeah, we'll go to next question. So for this, the answer is A. So this is the format where you can read the question there. So for this, and where the syntax is wrong in the first question, but that is a valid answer in the solution, where instead of that it's a drop table. So that should be drop external table, just external is missed. But while marking in examination, guys, make sure you are considering these things. Yeah, let's move to next question. Yeah, so this is nothing but a partition. If you are worked on the partition, it's just a straightforward question for that. If you want to move the data from one partition table to another table, then it's nothing. We can create an empty table with the same structure as your source table, and you can switch the partition. Once partition is done, then you can delete the drop, you can drop the staging table. So yeah, let's move to next question. Yeah, where the answer for this is session. So there are multiple consistency levels are there: strong, bound, stainless, eventual, session, consistency prefix. So where the session is the default one, we'll explain more. We have covered more questions on this part in the upcoming videos. So the answer is session, because within a single client session, reads are guaranteed to honor the consistency prefix. Okay, so that's why for monotonic reads or monotonic writes or read your writes and write follower reads guarantees, client outside of the session performing writes will see eventual consistency. So for this, the answer is session. Let's move to next question. Earlier I was telling, right, in the previous it's the same question. You need to implement the data masking and use the custom text mask. This is the answer for this question. So we'll move to next question. So for this, answer is yes, because whenever you are exporting data into an ORC file format, you might get Java out of memory errors. But when there are large, you might get this error when the files are large. To work around this limitation, what you need to do, you need to export only a subset of the columns. So that's why it's always recommended to modify the files to ensure that each row is less than 1 MB. Because as I mentioned, if it is more, then you will be getting Java out of memory exceptions. Let's move to next question. So for this, as I mentioned earlier, so the file should be less than 1 month, it 1 MB, it can't be more than 1 MB, that's why the answer is no. So next question is, answer is, you copy the files to a table that has a column store index. No, that is not an answer, because so for that, this is not an answer, so the answer should. So for this also, we can't do by using column store index. For this also, there should be a file which is a length, column length should be less than 1 MB. Next question. Where the answers are eventual session and consistence prefix. So this is the answer, where if we are using the multi-master, then your RPO should be less than 15 minutes, then you should go for the session consistency and the consistency prefix and the eventual levels. So so till now we gone through the all the implementing solution, but some of the questions you may get based on the Azure portal level as well. So if you read your question, is you need to ensure that you can recover any blob data from an Azure. Suppose if you delete your storage account, then you want to get that up to 30 days where you want to change in the Azure portal. So these questions also you will get sometimes, and I got two questions based on this. So for this, you need to follow this approach. What you need to do is you need to open the Azure portal, and from I have taken the screenshot and have pasted here. Open the Azure portal, and from there in the Azure block storage properties, you need to change your access tier to hot, so that what will happen, the cool access tier has lower storage cost and higher access cost compared to the hot storage. But this tier is intended for the data that will remain in the cool tier for at least 30 days. So you can follow this approach. So next question is, suppose you need to replicate your database to a new SQL server, name it this, in the Central Canada region, what you want to follow? These are the approach where you can, if you want to move to other region or anything, you can use the geo replication. Then from the geo replication, you can use the options as mentioned here, where the you can go to the configure option. Then here you can select South Central US or wherever you want to move your data, that is a replicated data. Then you can create a secondary data here. We'll go to next question. Suppose if you want to create an Azure SQL database named DB3 on an Azure SQL server named, that is a server name. So DB3 must be a sample source. So what you want to do? So for this, you nothing but in the Azure portal, you click on the create source. Then you select the database and you give the database name and all. Then you just finish it. It's just nothing but a creating a SQL database. So next question is, you plan to query DB3 to retrieve a list of sales customers, then the query will retrieve several columns that include email address and all. It's like a security question. So for that, you need to modify DB3 where only portion of email address is hidden in your result. If you want to consider like email address or credit card, we will be getting a masked, right? So how to achieve that? So for that, what you need to do, you need to select the dynamic data masking in the Azure portal. If you go to the settings of the DB3, you will be getting an option called dynamic data masking. You need to opt for that Yeah, these are the options you can go through. So here, once you click on the dynamic data mask, there it will show that you need to select the table. So in there table, you can select the column like email address, then you can add the mask. Then once you click, so automatically your column will get masked. So next question is, you need to increase the size of the DB2 to store up to 250 GB. Let's say while creating a database, you opted for 100 GB. Now you want to change to 250 GB. What you want to do? You need to go for these options. In the basic, you need to change. In the Azure portal, you navigate to the SQL database page, then select the DB2 database and choose the configure performance. So this is how. So once you change, obviously you will be getting the estimation like how much it will be on. You need to go to the standard and you need to select as per your requirement. Okay. So next question. Yeah, this is the answer where query joins two stream of partition data. Yes, and for all the questions it should be answered. Yes, because of the box one, you can now use a new extension of Azure Stream Analytics SQL to specify the number of partition of stream when reshuffling the data. For that, then for the box 2, it's yes, because when joining two stream of data explicitly, that is repartition, these streams must have the same partition key and partition count. So next one is also yes, because 10 partition into 6 SUS, it will become 60 SUS. So that is fine. So one thing you need to remember, streaming unit count, which is the unit of scale of Azure Stream Analytics, must be adjusted to the number of physical resources available to the job can fit into the partition flow. I mean, in general, if 6 SUS is good number to assign to each partition, in case there are insufficient resources into the job, the system will only apply the repartition if it benefits the job. Yeah, let's move to next question. Again, we came to one more practical question. You need to create an Elastic pool that contains an Azure SQL database. Earlier I was telling Elastic pool in previous questions, right? So here we can go through how to create. So here while creating the database, you will get an option called Elastic pools. There you can create, and these are the configure Elastic pools. You can select the database whatever you want to add. So yeah, this is the previous slides I went. So here once you click on the configure Elastic pool, you can go to the next one, that is the database, and then you can add the database. Once you added the database, then you can review and you can create one database. Yeah, now you need to minimize the store. Let me give you 1 second to read this question. Okay, let's move to the answer part. So here, if you go to the create storage account, then you can use the resource group name, whatever you want, you already created. Then on the Azure storage account window that appears, then you need to choose the add, and you need to select the subscription. Then you need to use the resource group, whatever earlier you created. Then these are the things you need to follow just to create a storage account. Let's move to next question. So you need to ensure that users in the West user region can read data from a local copy of an Azure Cosmos DB database named this. So in order to complete this task, what you need to do? So for this, what you need to do, you need to enable geo redundancy, multi-region rights, availability zone. You need to enable this, and these are in the steps I have clearly mentioned what are the steps you need to follow in order to come to this page in Azure portal. You can, if you navigate through Azure portal, then you will be getting these options. So here you can select the secondary server, and you can add the region wherever you want. Let's move to next question. You can read these questions. How to enable the Azure multi-factor authentication. So yeah, these are the options you can follow. In the Azure portal, you will be getting an Azure Active Directory options. So from there, you can follow these. Just I will give 1 to 2 seconds so that you guys can see the options how to navigate. Yeah. So we came to the next question. You have the following Azure Stream Analytics. You have the following Azure Stream Analytics. For each of the following statement, you need to select yes if the statement is true, otherwise select the name. So for this, the answer is yes, the query joins. Because this question, sorry, I think this is a duplicate question. We already looked into it. We'll move to next question. Yeah, so answer for this is from your application settings of DBON, you need to select the WestUS and create a target server and select the pricing tier. On the secondary server, create a login that matches the SID on the primary server. Then this regarding your application settings and all, we already looked into them in the previous questions. Your applications availability zone, multi-region, right? So that is also depending on the same question. Let's move to next question. So the answers are for the permission it select, then for and for mask it's random number. Then for box on why we select, for permission why we selected select, because who are the user with the select permission on a table, he can view the table data columns that are defined as mask. It will display the mask data. Okay, so that's why we are using the select statement. And for the box two, why we use the random number, because random number masking method which generates a random number according to the selected boundaries and actual data types. If your designated boundaries are equal, then the masking function is a constant number. So that's why we are going with the random number option. Yeah, so only two questions are left. Yeah, you guys can look into them. I will give 1 second. Answer is no, because by using apply on Azure policy that acts the storage account, you can't achieve this. For this, instead of this, what you the correct answer is you need to apply an Azure Blob Storage lifecycle policy. So that's why this is no. We go to next question. You apply an expired tag to the blobs in the storage account. So this is also no. Go to next question. You apply an Azure Blob Storage life policy. Answer is yes. As I mentioned earlier, this is the correct answer. So yes guys, so we completed set one, and I hope you guys are now much confident and you are very enthusiastic to watch the set two and set three. So I can assure by this 150 questions, minimum 95% to 96% of questions you will be same questions with the same options you will be getting, but maybe it's in jumbled order, but the questions will be valid and the answers are valid here, whatever I was showing. See, because these are validated and by the SMEs in the subject area. And yes, so guys, I hope this video will like video is liked by you. So I'm will meet in set two and set three videos. Just if you have not subscribed for our YouTube channel, please subscribe, like and share. Thank you so much. We'll see you soon.